and in 2006 publishing a paper proposing an electromagnetic cloak made out of metamaterials, stimulating much recent work in the field. He has since been awarded a number of prizes, including the Newton Medal from the Institute of Physics for his seminal contributions in surface space. And I'm very excited to hear his talk today on the invisibility cloak. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Sir John Pendry.
Distance, that this pole attracts that one, so on, that's the end of the matter. But there's another way of thinking about it, and that is that you can imagine that the first pole creates a field. And the field is there, whether or not it exerts a force on the second magnet. And then, if you put the second magnet there, it's a field that actually exerts the force. Now, a philosopher would say that is not the way to think about the problem, because philosophers apply Occam's razor, which is the simplest description. But sometimes describing the problem in a more complex way adds richness to a problem that enables you to take it one step further. And without the concept of a field, electromagnetism could not have been understood. It cannot be understood in terms of actual the distance. So these fields can be described by field lines, like streamers, and the lines begin and end only on magnetic north and south poles or positive and negative charges, or they may go around in a continuous loop. And the density of lines is the strength of the field. So there we have a physical concept which is mathematically exact because it relates to Maxwell's equations. And at the same time enables your mind to have a physical picture of what's going on. And therefore, you could use it as a creative instrument, as a design tool. And that's what we do. If you have some configuration here with an electric field or a magnetic field going in a certain direction, this is one of the field lines, then you can imagine that if you wanted that field line to go another way, you might take hold of space and bend the space. Now, you are aware, I'm sure, that what Einstein told us was that the space isn't sort of emptiness and nothingness. It's something which has a property, just as any material does, and that property is its geometry. You can change its geometry by putting a very massive object there. So let's suppose we put a very massive object and we bend space like this, and then, because the field lines are embedded in the space, you will change the direction of the field line as well. And Einstein, when he was formulating his theory of relativity, rewrote Maxwell's equations as they would look if the space was distorted. And what he found was that in Maxwell's equations, his quantity for the distortion of space he called the metric. And the metrics basically is quite a simple quantity that it does things. And it's how much space is squashed or stretched or pulled in one direction. And he found that the metric appeared in the same place in Maxwell's equations as the refractive index. So actually, if we want to change the direction of these field lines, it's not necessary to change space itself, because we can fool Maxwell's equations into thinking that space has changed by altering the refractive index. And Einstein also gave us a formula which relates the distortion of space to the metric, and hence, in our case, the refractive index. And so, now we have a tool which, instead of bending light at an interface and describing how that's done by an approximation, we can bend light by acting on the refractive index. And actually, what we in fact act upon are the electric and magnetic properties, which together make this refractive property of the material. And if you like mathematics, then this is Einstein's formula, the saying, if you have a distortion of the coordinate system, coordinate transformation from x to x prime, then the first derivative of this transformation tells you how you change the refractive index through electric and magnetic properties. So you can shove the field lines where you like, and at the end of the day, you can give a prescription of making a material which would do exactly that. And so this technology of transformation optics has given you back the intuitive feel for how electricity and magnetism works. But we're still left with the challenge of how to make those properties, because in nature we're given a very incomplete set of electromagnetic properties for materials. There are many things, many materials you might like to have, but they're just not there if you look in nature. And it was this in mind that we, some years ago, introduced this concept of a metamaterial, something which goes beyond ordinary materials. All materials have their electric properties, say, due to the chemical composition. And when you put an electric field, say, on this glass or what have you, then the response to that electric field is determined by how billions upon billions of tiniest atoms and molecules respond to that electric field. And the response as a whole is an average over what happens at the microscopic level. But it's also true that the things which respond to the field don't have to be as small as an atom or a molecule. They can be bigger things, like a little ring that's a nanometer in diameter, or a few tens of nanometers in diameter. Very difficult to make, but it's possible. The only criterion is that just like the atoms are smaller than the wavelength of light, these things also have to be smaller than the wavelength of the radiation. If it's light, then smaller than about half a micron. But there's still lots of room for engineering above the molecular level to make that happen. And of course, if you're working with radar waves, where the wavelength is 10 centimeters, then these things can be a few millimeters across and are really, really easy to make. So it was that the first structure which we made when I was consulting for the Marconi structure was this structure designed to work at microwave frequencies. And the size of this is about a centimeter across, and so the structure here is millimetric. And it was designed to give a magnetic response without using any magnetic materials. Because at 10 gigahertz, which is the radar frequency that this works at, the magnetic materials are beginning to get very messy and lossy and so on and so forth. And you can see how that might happen, because if you have a ring of copper, and if you put a magnetic field down the middle of the ring, then Faraday told us that that will induce a current going around the ring, and the current, in its turn, will create a magnetic response. And so you have a magnetic input, an electrical response, which in turn generates a magnetic response, current flowing in a loop. And so you're getting magnetism from a non-magnetic material. And you can make another little trick here. And this is what's called a split ring. So the current can't flow around here unless it jumps that gap. And that gap, it can jump because it's like a little capacitor. So what you have here is an electrical circuit. You have a capacitor, an inductor, and that makes something called a resonator. If you just hit that with a pulse, the current will flow backwards and forwards like that at a resonant frequency. Now, resonators have a very strange property which they all have in common, and you can see it is the simplest in a swing. So if you take a child's swing and you displace it, it will swing with a frequency which is given by the length of the chain holding the swing. If you have a child on the swing and you're a small child, you want it to be friendly, push it gently, slower than this resonant frequency, and the swing goes in the direction that you push. But if you try to make the swing faster, there's a limit. And eventually you come to a situation where you're pushing on the swing, and the swing didn't go that way, it would start to go this way. Have you ever tried that? Have you ever been the naughty brother to your sister? Don't try because it really shakes around. But what happens if you shake faster than the resonant frequency is the swing will go in the opposite direction to that which we push. And all resonators have that property. So if you take this resonant circuit here, then below this frequency, the magnetic response is in the same direction as the applied field. But above that frequency, the response inverts, and you get a negative response in the opposite direction to which you push, a very strange effect. So you get negative magnetism. And it turns out that that's something people have been seeking for a very, very long time, because it answered an old problem of how to make a material with a negative refractive index. And that had been the holy grail defined many years ago by a Russian called Vesalago. And he'd shown that if you could have a material with a negative refractive index, then it would have all sorts of other crazy properties as well. And if I have time, I'll mention a few of those at the end of my talk. So here's the first material with a negative refractive index. And Vesalago told us that if you make the electric and the magnetic response negative, then the refractive index will be negative, and light will bend the wrong way when it goes into this material. So instead of bending towards the normal, it will bend beyond the normal and faster, which is a negative refractive index. And to do that, David Smith at UCSD, now at Duke, my long-time collaborator, built this split ring structure with a green device, that gives me less material, and also another very, very simple structure, which we also recommended, which is just a simple wire, which is an electrical resonator, and that gives you X and less than zero. This had this property, and it was quite a sensation at the time. Of course, although Vesalago had given this recipe many years ago, nobody could make this stuff because no natural occurring material has this property. You have to go to metamaterials to do it. So, a few metamaterials. This is one for MRI frequencies, and it's now an insulated copper sheet wound round and round, and that just gives you more capacitance and inductance. Now, instead of 10 gigahertz, it's going to 24 megahertz. Of course, our military funding evaporated, and the medical people had lots of money, so we thought we'd do some MRI. And there is this negative refraction I spoke about earlier, with this angle here being in the opposite direction, the negative direction, and requiring this negative property. And people have made structures. The one I showed you worked with radar waves. This structure works at optical frequencies as a fishnet structure. But again, its properties are due to its structure, not to its intrinsic chemical composition. And that's the important part of the metamaterial. This particular one is made in Berkeley and consists of alternating layers of silver and the diagonal of absolute magnesium fluoride in this case. That's a sketch of what it should look like. Here's an electromagnograph of the structure as manufactured in Berkeley, and that shows negative refraction. Now that's an overview of the two things I want to talk about. One is this design technology of transformation optics, which tells you what you have to do if you want to manipulate electromagnetic field lines as freely as you wish. And the other technology, which is the metamaterial, which enables you to realize some of these exotic, sometimes exotic recipes, which the theoretical part of the story gives you. So finally, I come to invisibility. And conventional stealth, such as comes in fighter aircraft and so on and so forth, is just a matter of making something black. So conventional radar sends out a pulse and then listens for reflection. So if you have an object which is radar black, it doesn't produce a reflection, you don't see it. But in everyday life, with other sorts of radiation, you do see things which are black. You in fact, you notice that there is a shadow. So if you play squash, for example, you play with the black ball and the white court, and the ball is very, very visible. Because it creates a shadow. And the challenge is to get rid of the shadow. And when you do, Peter is invisible. You all know the story of Peter Pan, I assume. This boy who lost his shadow. This is his statue in Kensington Gardens, it's opposite my college. So how do we get rid of the shadow? Well, here's the way which we plan to do it. So here's what a ray of light would do, and a ray of light supports electric fields and so on. I just draw the ray here. And what you want to do is to have a region here which is hidden from light, so no light should ever reach this region. But not only that, you have to assure that this light, when it's directed away from this region, is not lost, because it will create a shadow if the light didn't continue on the way it would have done without all this stuff in place. So you have to make a cloak which grabs the ray, steers it around the object, and then carefully returns it to the same path it did before. And what's more, it's got to do that for all angles of incidence, all directions, and for both polarizations. Now, you could use the isopodes, sort of. But what a challenge to the computer, because the computer has to say, well, I go this way, oops, no, it's not coming out here at the right angle, let me try again, and so on and so forth. And then I'll try with this direction, no, what I've done right with it. You know, tremendous trial and error job to use Snell's law. And if you wanted to design a cloak using this principle, you would have had to invent something like transformation optics. So let me show you the transformation optics solution. The transformation optics solution says, aha, what I do here is to start with the flat space, I create a hole in the middle of it, and I push all of space, it's a rubber sheet, remember Einstein said space is made of rubber, and I push this material out of the region that light is excluded from. Because as I move space out, remember, all the fields that are embedded in that space are taken as you push the space, and they go into this region here. And then you can put in anything you want. Now you can put in some new space, leave it empty, you can put in something different, whatever. It's a hidden space. The light from outside can never get in here because you push all the space that was in there out of there. But what you have not done is mess with space outside this cloaking region here. So outside this region, you have not altered space, and therefore, you have not changed the trajectory of light which goes through it. So you see I just get excited with the technique for solving a mathematical problem which you know, you then keep complete or whatever, and then this just does it like that. And so here is the simplest formula you could imagine, that if you take space which we didn't fill this cylinder, sphere, what have you, sphere in this case, and just compress it radially, then this is the formula, simplest form. You can compress it any way as you want. This is just a linear compression, a fancier compressions you can think about. And that was the design for the first cloak. And here's the trajectory of rays of light which are going through this cloak here. And they're undeviated. People didn't realize it didn't believe that it would work and proposed it, but it was so simple, you know, this challenge of invisibility. And people said, well, I don't really believe it, and the people at Marlborough got their big electromagnetic solvers on it. By gosh, you know, yes, it does the job. but you have to do something a little bit, because this material here, it has some properties which are rather hard to come by. you use natural materials. It's anisotropic because you swash it one way and stretch it another. And also, it's inhomogeneous because the amount of squashing varies quite a lot across the globe.
And so, really, you couldn't build this without a nice material. You
do have incidents in nature where you have a continuous variation of the refractive index, and that happens in mirages where the hot air continuously changes the refractive index, and so light actually follows not a straight line but a curved path. And here in the UK, when you occasionally get a hot day, you see these rogue mirages in the distance when the sand is shallow enough that this mirage effect can see them. And the road looks wet, and when you get there, it isn't wet, it's just hot. But the practical realization was made a few months after the suggestion by David's team. And here it is. It employs these best materials. It's designed to work at radar frequencies, it's a cylindrical cloak. And you can see that by varying the internal mesh material, you can alter the refractive index of this cloak. You can go from the inside to the outside.
Actually, the cloak was a joke because I was invited by DARPA, the Defence Advanced Projects Research Agency, to address a meeting in San Antonio, Texas. And they said, your job is to ginger them up. So I thought, yes, well, okay, I'll give them a talk on transformation optics. And then at the end I said, oh, by the way, you can make something invisible, and here's a formula, which I've just shown you. And I expected everybody to laugh. But they didn't. They were very, very serious. And they offered me $500,000 at the end. So to do some work for them. Very nice. So the cloak hit the headlines, and we were speculating over dinner just why are people so surprised that you can make a cloak? I mean, sound bends around corners all the time, and you can hide things from sound, and we're not surprised by that. But we came to the conclusion that it's because we're so reliant on our sight to navigate, to get information about the world, and our brain is hardwired to think that light goes in a straight line. And when it doesn't, it's a bit like looking over a cliff. It's frightening you, and there's something, you know, weird out there, and my senses aren't working properly. But in fact, the physics is quite straightforward. So, despite the sensationalism around cloaking and so on, which we can now do, the fact is the really serious part of this work is the technology which enables you to make a cloak. And there are many other things which aren't as perhaps as sensational as cloaking that the technology can do, which will be perhaps more important than cloaking. Now I'll just show you one or two other examples of a cloak, and then I'll come on to negative refractive index, which is another aspect of transformation optics. So there are three ways. There's an alternative way of looking at a cloak. So one way of thinking of it is a sort of lens. Now, most lenses that you use are designed to make things more visible, to make them bigger. But you can also design lenses. For example, if you look through the wrong end of a telescope, it makes things smaller. And if you design a lens that makes things infinitely small, then they're invisible. Okay. So a cloak is a lens that makes something appear very, very small. And there are three ways you can do that. You can take an object and make a lens that crushes the object to a point. And whatever the properties inside the point, point-like objects are invisible. So that's what the spherical cloak does. But you can also make a cylindrical cloak. And guess what? That makes the object appear like a very, very thin wire. And if the wire is thin enough, doesn't matter what its properties are internally, it's invisible. Now, if you catch my drift, you'll see that the third one is when you squash something so that it's very, very flat. All right. But that isn't invisible. And in fact, its electrical properties are more like a metal, it turns out, when you've done squashing it. So you've made a mirror. A mirror is only invisible if you look at them like that. Okay. And where would you put a mirror to make it invisible? Very thin mirror. How about putting it on another mirror? Okay. So mirror plus mirror equals mirror. And you don't know that there are two mirrors there. So if you're in a situation, if you're on an radar circumstances, where you have something called a ground plane, the ground is very reflected, and seen reflected to the radars, and you squash it so that it appears flat with the ground, you hit it. Okay? And we call this the cockpit cloak. And hiding up the cockpit. And the reason we might go to the trajectory of 3 to 2 to 1 dimensional cloaking is that at each stage the material demands of a cloak get less and less severe. And what we wanted to do was to get to a situation where you could design a cloak which worked at optical frequencies. Of course, everybody was saying, oh daddy, please daddy, can I have a cloak like Harry Potter? And here it is. Well, not quite actually. So here is a two-dimensional cloak designed to work in silicon. So here's silicon, which is used in waveguides and so on, just below visible light, but the light is used in communications. And here you have prism, and here's the hidden object, and here's a cloak. And it's the simplest metamaterial you can imagine. It just alters the refractive index by drilling holes in it. Okay? So the density of holes changes, and with it, the refractive index of this object here. And here it is made in silicon with the focus line beam drilling the holes. This is electron micrograph. The scale is more micro here, so it ain't a big cloak. But it does hide this bump here. Now, the experiments they did was to shine light on this bump, and if you shone light on a bump and the light went over the bump, because this bump is a mirror and there's no cloak there, you'd see two beams of light from the two facets of the bump. But if you put the cloak there, then wherever you shone the light, you would see only one beam, which would be consonant with a flat mirror. So here the experiments and the theory. I don't know which are which because we agree. But this is what a flat mirror should look like. Single reflection. If you have an object that you want to hide but have not yet hidden, then the light will reflect the process of that object, multiple beams, so you know something's there. But if you put this cloak in place, again, the thing appears to be a flat object and you don't know it. There. So that's the first optical or near optical demonstration of a cloak. But the real challenge of this mathematics is that it replaces Snell's law. So as well as working for light and rays of light and really big things, which is the main of Snell's law, it also works for any sort of electromagnetic field. So if you can cloak for light, you can cloak for radar waves, can you cloak a static magnetic field? And the answer is, yes, you can. You can produce formula, and the same formula that would cloak for light or radar waves should also cloak for static magnetic fields. So this picture is of a design tool replaces rays with these much more general concepts of field lines, even static field lines. So it turns out that when you make this cloak, there's a very simple rule which is if you squash space an object like this in the direction perpendicular to the squashing, you increase its magnetic and electric response, both by the same proportion. But along the direction of squashing, you reduce
the response. So it has a smaller magnetic response along the direction you squash. Now, if you look at this cloak here, what you've done is to squash space in this direction. So perpendicular to that in the angular direction, we want a magnetic response, and the cause of magnetic field is static. We're only concerned with magnetism, so we only have to worry about the magnetic response. So you want a response which is greater than free space. So that's okay because you have iron, paramagnetics, and so on. There are lots of materials which will give that to you. But in this direction, you have what's called a diamagnetic material. And a diamagnetic material is one which has a response less than free space. And materials like that are known in nature, but a very strong natural diamagnetic response would be when the response is like 0.95 of the vacuum response, 95%. And what you want here is something that's like 30%, 10%, very, very strong diamagnetic response. It's just a very simple. So we had to design one, and that's where metamaterials came in again. Now you may know that a superconductor has an interesting property. It's called the Meissner effect. And when something becomes a superconductor, it just hates magnetic fields and will repel them out of the superconducting object. So magnetic fields only get inside the superconducting objects by a very small, less than a micron. And so if you have superconducting plates, then magnetic fields won't penetrate those magnetic plates. Now these are thin plates with small gaps between them. So if I put magnetic field lines along this direction, because the plates are thin, you hardly see any disturbance in the magnetic lines. And you're free to fill this space with some paramagnetic material, so you can have a very strong positive magnetic response here. But what about this direction here? The field lines can't, if we want to get from one side to the other, you've got to squash them. And squashing field lines increases the magnetic energy density and the big energy cost. And that means that this stuff doesn't like magnetic field lines in this direction, which is a signature of a very strong diamagnetic material. So in this direction, you get a mu, which is much less than one. And I have a table here. So our experiment is made those structures. And here is the predicted magnetic response, which is predicted to be 25%, and even you could go down almost at 0% magnetic response in that direction. And here's the measured permeability. So you see that that is reasonably well, and what this experiment is certainly measuring really unheard of diamagnetism here. And that's what you need to make this magnetic cloak. So my postdoc Ben Wood put together a design and said, this is what you must do if you want to make a cloak. Our experimentalists just wandered off and did their stuff and didn't make this thing. And they're excited for a number of years. And then a couple of years ago or so, this paper appeared from Harvard. And these people had taken up the design and they made this cloak in just the way we said. So these are sheets of lead with gaps between them, and when you cool lead to a few degrees Kelvin, it becomes superconducting, and then between these sheets, they put some very strong magnetic material, chromium, thermoalloy, and they made the cloak according to this design. And to test it, they made the cloak in a cylindrical form, and they put it between two electromagnets, and then wrapped up the current so that the magnetic field increases. So if you know cloak, this is what the magnetic field would look like. And if you put on cloak, you should see these lines bent around here, but not disturbed outside. Now I'm going to contrast that with, have I got the pictures here to do that? Yeah, no, I don't. I have to tell you about it. Now, there are ways of excluding magnetic fields from a given volume. One of them is to wrap a very strong ferromagnetic material like new metal around that area, and that will attract all the lines to itself and keep them away from that central region. But magnetic screening is different, because if you screen, merely screen, you do keep the fields away, but also you create a massive disturbance in these field packs outside. So that's not cloaking at all. A true cloak excludes the lines, gathers them in here, but doesn't touch these outside at all. And so the test is to measure the fields here inside where they should vanish, and here outside where they should be changed. So let's see how that works. So that's where a sketch of where the field line should go, no change, zero. And so if you look at sensor one, and you have no cloak, then the fields increase uniformly with the current in the electromagnet. If you put the cloak there, it's excluded as it should. If you look at the sensor outside the cloak, then of course it's just the same if there's no cloak. But also, if you put the cloak there, there's no disturbance in the fields. So it is doing this job of cloaking, and there's no magnetic shadow. So that's a job. I mean, an optical cloak, you could conceive of designing with Snell's law. It was very hard, but you could conceive of doing it. You couldn't conceive of making this design using Snell's law, because Snell's law has nothing to say about magnetic fields, right? It's not in the domain that Snell thought about. So I have a few minutes left. And before I finish, I'd like to go on a bit about this negative refraction stuff. Now, you may think that if light went this way rather than that way, big deal. What's so special about that? But I want to show you that this is something which is very special indeed. So, one thing that Bessel-Arnaud noticed was that this stuff can act as a lens, even though it has a flat surface. So if you do a bit of ray tracing, and you have a source of light in here, then it refracts at the surface and comes to a focus here, all right? So if you had a fish pond with negative refracting water in it, your fish would appear to be swimming in thin air above the pond. That's the first curious thing, just by applying the laws of refraction. But there's another way you can think of this lens, and it's according to these principles which Einstein talked about, light being the space being made of rubber, and what happens to it if you change its density. So if you imagine this is some space, okay, and so I'm going to I've already said that if you squash space in this direction, you make the thing more refractive, okay, so we send light this way, and light is going through this region of space which I'm now going to squash. And it gets more and more refractive when you just squash it more and more. Okay. So now you've got a very thin piece of space which is highly refractive. So highly refractive, it does the same job of changing the phase and everything of a longer region of space. But now, of course, I'm a theorist, so I can push it even further, right? And push it like that. And now I've done something very strange to space. I've not only squashed it, I've altered its topology. So here, I have three manifolds. Okay. So now the light comes in, it goes back and it comes forward again. It retraces its steps. So if I have light which is from a comes to a focus here, the focus will diverge and then it hits the surface and it retraces its steps and comes to a focus a second time, and then it hits this second boundary and it comes through the focus. So here I just got one sheet, and you can see that happening, but I have another slide way, way down here. Oh, sorry, I missed it. Now, if you adopt this more instinctive notation that I show you here, this is what the light thinks it's doing. And therefore, you get these three foci because it's actually retracing this piece of state, tracing this piece of space three times because of this negative refractive index you've created by making some negative space. But there's more to it than that. And it's this, that Snell's law is an approximation. And these foci, the focus of the conventional lens, is not a perfect focus. You can never make it finer than the wavelength of light. But this focus here is derived not using an approximation factor of equations, transformation optics is exact at the level of Maxwell's equation. So if this is a point of light here, it will also be a point of light here. And there is no limit to how finely you can focus that light, providing that you can realize this condition, which is a very stringent one, of the refractive index being exactly minus one. And so the notion which has held sway for many, many years, that light cannot be focused more finely than the wavelength of light is in error. And I published a paper in 2000 called The Perfect Lens, which resulted in a great deal of slander on myself, but it's still the test of time. And essentially, this is the argument which that you can make a perfect focus by taking a material with a negative refractive index. And let me just show you one or two fun consequences of that. So here's one thing you can do with your negative refractive material, but something else you can do. So when you've done folding something back on itself like this, you can say, well, that's not terribly interesting because although it's perfect, the image is exactly the same size as the object. You want a lens to magnify things or see small things or whatever. And so you can go further with that picture. You can bend this around, and when you bend the space, you stretch the image and you curve the space which is occupied by the negative material. So you can in fact bend this lens around, and now you're making a magnifying glass, and everything inside this green sphere is magnified by this lens, which is entirely contained in the blue sphere, but externally appears to this even bigger sphere, which is a magnified complex of what's inside here. And so, if you this one too really good. Were this a milk bottle, you'd be able to see that it had white contents. And you would also see that the milk. milk goes, as the water does, right to the edge of the glass, right? You can't see water and then glass. The water goes right to the edge. And it's a very simple thing, because any ray of light which strikes a milk bottle will be refracted into the milk, whatever angle it comes in at. So you never notice that glass is there, because it always appears to be filled with milk, all right? Simple refraction thing, I don't know. Notice that if you mentioned on your complex, but there it is. But imagine you had a milk bottle which was made of a negative refractive material to this design. Then the milk would appear not inside the bottle, but out here. How can that be? Just to let you know how very strange that is, I'll do some ray tracing for you. So here's this perfect lens, and remember it's entirely contained inside this blue circle or sphere. So let's do a bit of Snell's stuff. So this ray, it's normal, it goes right through. This ray negatively refracts, so this is a negative angle here, and negatively refracts and goes right through. So you notice that these rays are big outside and they're close together inside here. So what's inside here is magnified, what's outside here appears smaller inside outside, okay? And that's the law. But the law says that everything that hits this red sphere hits the red sphere, whether or not it hits the lens, should go inside here. There's a problem. Because here's the last ray which actually hits the lens. So it does the right stuff. It refracts at a very, very sharp angle and then comes in here and escapes again. But this lens doesn't touch anything. How on earth can you find out here? Here's a computer simulation according to Maxwell's equation. Do you see these? And now, of course, it's waves. You see these wavefronts rather than rays. But the wavefronts are all compressed and perfectly filled, not half of this thing, but the whole thing here. So this demonstrates in a very dramatic fashion that there are situations where Snell's law just comes up with the wrong answer. And of course, we think of the world as Snell's law, and rays and so on and so forth. This is as surprising as invisibility. Now, the explanation for that, for this, is you can understand as follows. So suppose a ray did get inside here. So it would go along and refract round and round and round. It would be trapped in here. It would be one of these things I call a resonance. And also, the other thing you have to remember is that rays of light, in reality, can never be made infinitely thin. There are always things called, the very narrowest thing you can make is called a Gaussian beam, which has a cross-section with tails on. So these are not infinitely thin rays going through space. They're, in fact, a compression of waves, and they're not perfectly compressed. They have little tails on them. And these tails tickle these resonances. And the resonance grabs the energy and gradually over time builds up to this picture here. So if you switched on the light suddenly, the light would flood into the bottom half, and then very, very slowly it would eat of these beams and build up to the picture that the ray picture can't show, but which the wave picture reveals. Another way that transformation optics can look at these things. Now, one thing you can do with this is that there are many devices in the optical world which only work if they're very big, because they're designed using ray optics, and ray optics assumes that everything's much bigger than the wavelength, so you don't see any diffraction. And one of the things is a shadow. So if you take an object which is very, very small, It doesn't have a shadow because the light, just like water flowing around something, the diffraction effects fill in the light behind the object almost as soon as it gets past the object. So you can't make shadows with very small things. But one way you can get around this rule is to pop a very small black object in here and then use this lens to make that black object, small black object, be a very big black object. So it would appear not only to be bigger than black, but bigger than the lens itself. Okay, so put a black object in here with the lens, you get a really, really big black object here. So you can have this whole thing some wavelength, and yet you could make a big shadow. And this is a simulation by my former student, Wei Shun. We did this computer simulation. And what we have here is a black inner object, a lens, such as I showed you, and empty space here. And then we have a beam of light coming from this side. And the computer simulation shows it makes this really big shadow, which is bigger than any of the objects here. So, I think that might be a good way to pause, but I just say that this whole subject of transformation optics and metamaterials, I hope I've shown you that it has this very amusing and entertaining consequence of being able to hide something which surprises us all. But there are many other things that it can do which were impossible before. And it is beginning to have an impact in the wider world. If you look at these, this is a bit old now, but anyway, if you bring it up today, the trend continues. So this is the number of papers which are published on metamaterials and the number of citations which the subject reaches in a year. So not only are people finding this a very interesting and amusing thing, it's also something which is very useful in having an impact on the way people think about electromagnetism. This subject, which has been with us in a complete set of equations for 150 years, but those equations have the immense subtlety that they're still revealing very new and surprising things to us. And I'll leave it there. Thank you very much.
All right.